group also. So we have talked about Sanatan Dharma yesterday, and we have seen that how the constitutional position of the living entity is to serve Krishna selflessly. And in that way, only the living entity can be happy. And constantly, selflessly and constantly, only then the living entity can be happy. In the Bhagavad Gita, worship of different demigods or rendering service to them is not approved. It is stated in the 7th chapter, 20th verse, Kamaistaistair hrita jnanah prapadyante anni devata tam tam niyamam asthaya prakritya niyata soya. Kamaistaistair hrita jnanah prapadyante anni devata. Those whose intelligence have been stolen by lust for enjoying these material objects, they surrender to Anya Devata. Anya Devata means other than Lord Krishna. Tam tam niyamam asthaya prakritya niyatasvaya. That means being situated in those rules and regulations which are needed for worship of the demigod. Prakritya niyatasvaya. By their own swabhav, which is formed by association with the modes of material nature, the living entity worships a particular demigod. That means if he is in mode of ignorance, he will worship a demigod who is in mode of ignorance. If he is in mode of passion, then he will worship a demigod who is in mode of passion. And if he is in mode of goodness, then he will worship a demigod who is in mode of goodness. But if a person who is transcendental consciousness or he has transcendental faith, then he will worship Krishna as per the scriptures. Okay. Those whose intelligence has been stolen by material desires surrender unto demigods and follow the particular rules and regulations of worship according to their own natures. And also we have to understand, we might know this sloka, but you should understand that what is the meaning of hrita jnana? They are not understanding that they are soul. That is the first point of transcendental knowledge, that a person understand that I am soul, I am not the body. And also understanding that his body is only giving me misery. One devotee was nicely mentioning to me that his body is like a field and the only produce from this field is misery. So understanding that in no situation, even if I become a demigod, it's not that I'll become less miserable. I will remain miserable only. So I am actually soul, and soul can only be satisfied by serving Krishna. Then a person begins to worship Krishna properly. So because these people are only one thinking that I will get a son by getting a son or by getting other things, by getting a cow or other things, so many things, a field, I'll be happy, that's how they worship a particular demigod. Here it is plainly said that those who are directed by lust worship the demigods and not the Supreme Lord Krishna. And this we have discussed several times, that whenever they are worshipping a demigod, their desire or interest is not to satisfy the demigod, so that they have love for the demigod. Rather, their desire is to fulfill or get something material from the demigod. So they are not attached to the demigod per se, but they are attached to the sense gratification which will be available by worshipping the demigod. Is it understandable? Yes. Okay. When we mention the name Krishna, we do not refer to any sectarian name. Krishna means the highest pleasure, and it is confirmed that the Supreme Lord is a reservoir or a storehouse of all pleasure. We are all hankering after pleasure. Anandamayo bhyasat. The living entities like the Lord are full of consciousness and they are after happiness. The Lord is perpetually happy, and if the living entities associate with the Lord, cooperate with Him and take part in His association, then they also become happy. Now you see, in a very simple way, Srila Prabhupada is explaining the real source of happiness. Whatever we are doing in this world, the only goal is that I should become happy. Whether it's marriage, whether it's procreating some children, getting some whatever house, or getting a job, we are not against any of these things. But you can very clearly say, nobody will say, I want to get married because I want to be miserable. No, it's not a question of knowing. They actually are convinced that by getting married, I'll be happy. Sukhaya karmani karoti loke. Nobody is getting married or a mother ne bol diya tha, pita ne bol diya tha. No, it's not like that. You are convinced if mother says that you jump in a field or sorry, jump in a well, will you not jump? Nobody can say it's because my mother told or father told I'm getting married. They are also convinced that by this sense gratification, I'll be happy. Are you able to understand? All of us want to do something which will make us happy. But the problem is we do not know where to look for happiness and how to look for happiness. So even when we are worshipping Krishna, to the degree we are selfless in our Krishna consciousness, to that degree we will be happy in Krishna consciousness. So that's what Prabhupada is saying, that we have to learn to associate with the Lord and cooperate with Him. Cooperate means Krishna is the master and I must serve Him as per His instruction. I must live my life as per His instruction. Only then I can be happy. Because Krishna will reveal the happiness within the heart of the devotee. Make sense? Okay. The Lord descends to this mortal world to show His pastimes in Vrindavan, which are full of happiness. When Lord Sri Krishna was in Vrindavan, His activities with His cowherd boyfriends, with His damsel friends, and with other inhabitants of Vrindavan, and with the cows were all full of happiness. The total population of Vrindavan knew nothing but Krishna. But Lord Krishna even discouraged His father Nanda Maharaj from worshipping the demigod Indra, because He wanted to establish the fact that people need not worship any demigod. They need only worship the Supreme Lord, because their ultimate goal is to return to His abode. So, are you able to understand that point? First point which is being mentioned here is that when Krishna comes, He does all these pastimes which are like a trailer. The trailer is shown so that the people become attracted and they go and watch the movie. Is it not? We have watched the movie, so we understand the example. Similarly, Krishna shows pastimes which are eternally happening in Goloka, and He manifests them for some time in this world so that people become attracted to those pastimes and they desire to enter into those pastimes. When the desire is coming, and then the person will do necessary steps of sadhan by which he can enter into those pastimes. They are not anything mundane or material. Otherwise, if Krishna had associated with the gopis, why will He allow them to be put in a shastra? Are you able to understand? If it was something bad, if somebody is associating with other girls and it is bad, why will He get it published in a newspaper? Nobody would like to do that. Because in this world, these things are mundane and bad. So we are imposing that conception on Krishna's participation in Rasalila with the gopis. Is it very clear? So one has to very clearly understand that the thing is, I am so happy with, and see how much happy my associates are. So why don't you also come? That is the whole plan of Krishna. And that's why He descends again and again. Does it make sense? No? Yes. And for that, what we have to do? We don't have to do any tapasya. Basically, what we have to do, just exclusively worship Krishna. And why worship Krishna? So that I may also have one day the same love which the Brajvasis have for Krishna. I may be very low. I am low, there is no doubt. But my aspiration is that one day I will have love for the Lord as the Brajvasis have. This is the definition of bhakti. I engage in Krishna's service by my senses. It's not that somebody else will hear and my bhakti will increase. I have to do bhakti with my senses so that the dormant love which is in my heart becomes manifested in due course of time. This is called sadhana bhakti. Simple definition. Samaj mein aa raha hai? Sadhana bhakti is not called sadhana bhakti when I am doing bhakti of Krishna for material desires. That is not called sadhana bhakti. It is called sadhana bhakti only when I want to develop the love which Mother Yashoda or other inhabitants of Vrindavan have for Krishna eternally. And it's very simple prayer. A devotee, Mahaprabhu himself, is praying to Krishna, Prema bina vyartha mora daridra jivan. दास करी वेतन मोरा दिया प्रेम धन। ओ कृष्णा विदाउट लव फॉर योर लोटस फीट माय लाइफ इज यूजलेस, सो प्लीज एंगेज मी इन योर सर्विस एंड ब्लेस मी विद लव ऑफ गॉड। यू अंडरस्टैंड ऑल दिस थिंग्स। द अबोड ऑफ लॉर्ड श्री कृष्ण इज डिस्क्राइब्ड इन द भगवद गीता 15th चैप्टर 6th वर्स। न तद भासयते सूर्यो न शशांको न पावक यद्गत्वा न निवर्तन्ते तद्धाम परमं मम। दैट सुप्रीम अबोड ऑफ माइन इज नॉट इल्यूमिनेटेड बाय द सन और मून नॉर बाय फायर और इलेक्ट्रिसिटी। दोज हु रीच इट नेवर रिटर्न टू दिस मटेरियल वर्ल्ड। नाउ देयर इज सम डाउट, प्रभु जी what if we go back to spiritual world and come back and fall back here? So what is your answer? What does Krishna say here? Yad gatva na nivartante tad dham paramam mama. This knowledge seems to be very simple, but why don't we focus our life in achieving this goal? Sometimes we don't reflect. Think about all those people who have got married. I have no problem if people get married, but I'm just think about it. Got married, have some kids, then had some property. What did they achieve? And then everything has to be left. I mean, obviously everybody has to do as per his karma. We have no objection to that, but you understand, everybody gets guided by his karma to marry and whatever. But what did he achieve? Like my father left the body. Now, what did he achieve? Putting all those energies in that. Are you able to see that in life? What that person is achieving? Prabhupada says that this life is like flapping wings for 50, 60 years and then dying. It's like a bird is flapping wings for some time and then just leave the body. What did I achieve? Ki sukha paya? And what happiness did I get? It is by that reflection we can understand the futility, understand uselessness of all these endeavors. What I am going to achieve by that? Now people, a person who is completely influenced by a mode of passion, he has to be engaged. That's a different thing. But a person who is, reflective, in some sense, he says, why should I endeavor for all those things? Why should I not endeavor for this goal, which is also not so easy to attain? Krishna Prem is also not so easy to attain. It may take maybe many lifetimes also. But let me try for this only. Because in this, this is the only path which is progressive. Whatever bhakti I am doing, it is getting added to my account. So why not align my life so that I can focus on my this goal only? नहीं समझ में आ रहा है। दिस वर्स गिव्स अ डिस्क्रिप्शन एंड वंस आई गो बैक टू गॉड हेड फिनिश्ड देन नो एवर फॉर टाइम इटर्निटी नो प्रॉब्लम। वन डिवोटी वॉज गिविंग अ जोक दैट वी आर सो अकस्टम टू प्रॉब्लम्स एंड देर इज नो प्रॉब्लम दैट इटसेल्फ इज अ प्रॉब्लम। इजंट इट सम डे इफ देर इज नो प्रॉब्लम then we feel, अरे आज कुछ है ही नहीं करने के लिए, there is nothing to do today. Have you not seen that? We are so accustomed to having solving some problems in this world because it's a kuntha jagat. We cannot conceive of a place which is completely filled of happiness, eternity, bliss. It's called Vaikuntha. And this very simple point is, chant Hare Krishna, do service to Krishna, now we go back to Godhead. It's so powerful process. Mahaprabhu says, even if a person has chanted Krishna once and he does not criticize others, then I will personally deliver him. Can you understand the process of chanting Hare Krishna is so powerful? And no other mantra, nothing, you search the YouTube, anything, nobody tells also that where is the spiritual world and how you can achieve it. They have no information. You can touch, search way, how to become liberated, how to go to spiritual world. You just cannot get any answer. Any questions are there? Okay. So, there should be no doubt within the mind of a devotee. Once you go there, you will never come back. Shripad Ramanujacharya explains that you will not come back because there is no reason to come back. You have attained the Lord who is so sweet. So why will you come on to come back to this world? This verse gives a description of that eternal sky. Of course, we have a material conception of the sky and we think of it in relationship to the sun, moon, stars and so on. But in this verse, the Lord states that in that eternal sky, there is no need for the sun, nor for the moon, nor electricity or fire of any kind, because the spiritual sky is already illuminated by the Brahmajyoti, the rays emanating from the Supreme Lord. This has to be understood. Lord Krishna is in Goloka, and in Goloka, from his transcendental body, or body, not body but transcendental form, there is an emanation. Emanation means light which comes from his transcendental form, and that is called Brahmajyoti, which illuminates all Vaikuntha planets. That way, information we are getting from Shastra. Have you not noticed that as we are reading this, there is a desire getting implanted in my heart, what I am doing here, wasting my life? Do you feel like this? What do you think, Sundar Madhav? What I am doing, wasting my life here? Yes, I do not belong to this place. This is the effect of transcendental knowledge. You must have read this, but again and again, the more we hear it again and again, the more we get convinced, I just should try to maintain this body so that I can execute Krishna consciousness as much as possible. We become sick, we take medicine so that we can execute Krishna consciousness. We can chant Hare Krishna. This is very nice. What is the value of becoming famous? What is the value of becoming anything in this world? Obviously, a person in mode of passion won't accept that. But a person with transcendental knowledge will understand, nothing is satisfying me. Even my efforts for sense gratification are not satisfying me. Make sense? So, this is how the world is. We are trying with difficulty to reach other planets, but it is not difficult to understand the abode of the Supreme Lord. Yes, very nice. If you just think, very nice point Prabhupada is saying, if you compare, if I have to go to moon planet using a Sputnik or something, there is so much more endeavor needed than if you want to go back to Godhead. Do you accept this point? Kitna tapasya karna padega? There's so much tapasya, hours and hours of this. And then even if they go to Chandrama or Moon, then what do they bring? They bring some dust. Even if you accept that they have gone, most probably they have not gone on. So now compared to that, what we have to do to go back to Godhead? Chant 16 rounds offenselessly. Not 16 rounds in the way that I'm doing something also and Hare Krishna, Ram Ram, that won't really help. I am sometimes a little hard on this also. Chanting Hare Krishna 16 rounds means taking it as an exclusive engagement. Trying to chant very attentively, nicely. Then you will see the difference of consciousness the Mahamantra can make. Are you able to understand? It's a meditation. It's not simply a side business. If we give it as a side business, then we will not get the same benefit. Purposefully, if we do not pay attention, chanting Hare Krishna also and talking, chanting Hare Krishna and checking WhatsApp, then those realizations will not descend. The problem, I will tell you one nice point, the same thing, going back to Godhead. One time, Sripad Ramanujacharya, you know that pastime, Sripad Ramanujacharya, who is a great acharya, he, after begging for 17 times, got initiated in the Narayana mantra, Om Namo Narayanaya. Now his guru told that by chanting this mantra, a person will go back to Godhead, to Vaikuntha. But you should not give to unqualified people, otherwise you will go to hell. You know this pastime. And then Sripad Ramanujacharya was a great acharya. Everybody was knowing him. So he went in a watchtower and said, okay, please everybody come and hear. And everybody came. And he says, you please chant, Om, Om, Namo, Namo, Narayanaya, Narayanaya. He says that if you chant this mantra, you will go to Vaikuntha. So now the Guruji told that, what is this? Now you will go to hell. So he said, that's not a problem. If I go to hell and everybody goes to Vaikuntha, it should not be a problem. Then his Guruji said, Ati Karuna, Ati Karuna. I mean, your mercy, your compassion is amazing. So this Mahamantra, the same thing. Om, just like Om Namo Narayanaya, is the mantra by which a devotee is transported to Vaikuntha. Similarly, Hare Krishna mantra is a mantra by which a devotee is transported to Goloka. But why his Guruji was so against it? Because he was knowing that people will not value it. Similarly, so many people they give up chanting Hare Krishna because they don't understand the potency of Hare Krishna mantra. Golokera prema dhana Hari nama sankirtan. It is has been brought from Goloka, and this is like a lift or a rope which will take us back to Goloka. So you are understanding what, if our goal is very clear. Just suppose if I want to do very good in exams, then the way I'll prepare or the way I study will also be very nice. And if I don't know why I'm studying, then I will not put any effort in studying. Similarly, if I know the goal is to develop love of God, go back to Godhead, then my sadhana, the level of absorption, my effort in doing my chanting will be much more. Than just simply chanting for the sake of chanting or whatever like that. Which also is good in any way. But I'll put effort. Are you able to understand what I'm trying to say? Okay. But it still is very easy compared to making a Sputnik and trying to go to moon. This abode is referred to as Goloka. In the Brahma Samhita, it is beautifully described. Goloka eva nivasatya khilatma bhutah. The Lord resides eternally in his abode Goloka, yet he can be approached from this world, and to this end the Lord comes to manifest his real form, Sachidananda Vigraha. When he manifests this form, there is no need for our imagining what he looks like. To discourage such imaginative speculation, he descends and exhibits himself as he is, as Shyam Sundar. Why Prabhupada is saying this point? If Lord would have never descended, people would have only continued to say he is impersonal. Even when he's coming so many times, still people say he's impersonal. What to talk of when he would have never come? That is the point. So that's why he comes and he shows himself, see, this is how I look. This is how you can worship me like this. Unfortunately, the less intelligent deride him because he comes as one of us and plays with us as a human being. But because of this, we should not consider the Lord one of us. It's a beautiful point Prabhupada is explaining in this. You have to be very careful. We're highlighting this point. Just because the Lord by his causeless mercy is manifesting among the human beings, does not mean that he's a human being. He's an eternal Krishna, is Supreme Lord himself. Similarly, when the Lord is manifesting on our tongue in the form of Hare Krishna, 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 Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Ram Ram, Hare Hare. So the conditioned soul who is conditioned by the modes of material nature cannot understand that the Lord is personally descending on his tongue. And that's why we tend to become negligent. But the acharyas understand that the name is Krishna himself, Krishna Purna Vapushe Namo Namaha. So borrowing the faith from the acharyas, from Srila Rupa Goswami, who have realization that the name is not different from Krishna, we should chant Hare Krishna as respectfully as possible, as if Krishna is coming on a tongue. Not as if he is coming on a tongue, but I don't have realization, I do not have anubhuti, but borrowing or taking the instruction from Srila Rupa Goswami that he is Krishna himself, Srimati Radharani herself, in the form of the transcendental vibration, although it may appear to be a material vibration, it is never to be considered a material vibration. Just like the Lord must never be considered a normal human being. Similarly, the deity is Krishna himself. Pratima nahi tumi sakshat Brajendra Nandan. And borrowing the faith or taking the faith from Shastra, we should behave in that way. Make sense to you? And in that way, we can get reciprocation. It is by his omnipotency that he presents himself in his real form before us and displays his pastimes, which are replicas of those pastimes found in his abode. So you understand this point? Just like the Lord cannot be seen by our senses. The Lord cannot be approached by our senses, but the Lord can come in our senses. There are two points. The senses cannot catch the Lord, but the Lord can catch our senses. Atah Sri Krishna Namadi na bhavet grahyam indriyai सेवोन्मुखे हे जीवादौ स्वयमेव स्मृत अधः. सो आई एम नॉट ए माई सेंसेस कैन नॉट कैच द लॉर्ड, माई सेंसेस आर मटीरियल, बट वेन आई डिजायर द लॉर्ड टू सर्व द लॉर्ड शुड कम ऑन माई टंग, देन ही कम्स बाई हिज omnipotency, by achinta shakti in the form of a sound vibration of Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Ram Ram, Hare Hare. So this transcendental science has to be properly understood. Just like this, words may seem to be very simple. We are reading some English, but because these words are connected with Krishna, they are liberating to the effect that as long we are reading and discussing, the death cannot touch us. So we'll stop here and then continue tomorrow, Krishna willing. If there are any questions, let me just check. Right now there are no questions, so shall we stop here? Srimad Bhagavad Gita ki jai, Srila Prabhupada ki jai.